And before I was interrupted, I do have to say that Mrs. Hennessy very often says things that make me want to scream, and I desist from doing it. But I had discussed the, I was going through the four items that we're concerned with, and number four was the need for planning permission on the Slade Road site. And I don't know quite what Mrs. Hennessy objected to, but anyhow, what I said was, Councillor Pasley states that he believed that the Slade Road site might not need planning permission because it was already approved as a recreational area, and installation of further recreational equipment would be routine. It was uncertain and was not resolved until a pre-application was made apparently at a cost of £80. Only then did it become clear that a larger concrete installation would require planning permission. Once again, we have a tenuous basis for the accusation of lying. It's difficult to see where any motivation could exist for Councillor Pasley to gain from attempting deception in this matter. I have to conclude that these four accusations levelled against Councillor Pasley are substantially false. Perhaps it's Mr. Maltby who should stop coming to these meetings. I can only refer to him in his own words when he recommended that Councillor Pasley should resign. He said if he can't tell the truth, he's not wanted here. But we must ask ourselves why people such as Mr. Maltby are using far-fetched arguments to accuse councillors of dishonesty. I think the answer is now well known. Some people are actively preparing what I call the Great Portishead Swindle. This town has a history of voting Conservative or Liberal Democrat, and sometimes a well-known independent. Those standing for Labour and further left have become frustrated, and they are now making plans to get elected by deception. Plan one is to disguise themselves as independents so that the left-wing politics will be hidden. Plan two is to justify this by saying that party politics is bad and that existing councillors, particularly Conservatives, are following party instructions to the detriment of the town. This is a complete lie. No one in North Somerset, and certainly no one in Westminster, has ever made any request for my knowledge or even taken any interest in small matters under town council control. Plan three is to tell everyone that existing councillors are liars and corrupt. It would be possible to say that about anyone, but not the slightest good evidence is to be offered. But they hope that with repetition some will believe it. This too is a complete lie. The North Somerset Standards Subcommittee exists to deal with such allegations, and I know of no case which has been successfully brought. All I can say is that we know what you're up to, and we'll be making sure that everyone else does. But I must congratulate Mr. Maltby on preparing a well-presented and logical dossier. If he wishes to take it further, he should present it to the monitoring officer at North Somerset Council for submission to the Standards Subcommittee. But on the basis of what I've seen, I'm not optimistic that it will get very far. And on the same evening, our own dear Mrs. Hennessy made similar accusations. At first I thought I would not bother writing to her, but later decided to do so, to be consistent. I received a 7-page diatribe. Its content was similar to her public participations, which soured the atmosphere at most of our meetings. Unlike Mr. Maltby, she did not concisely focus on the matter in question, but recited many alleged sins of several councillors, including myself. I wrote back to her thanking her for her voluminous reply, but asking for specific information about the particular accusations I was looking into. Her reply began with the statement, "I do not make accusations." I was speechless. She seems to me to do little else with every hour that she's awake. Mrs. Hennessy's behaviour, as we all know, is somewhat eccentric. We've seen evidence of it tonight. I think it's best to ignore her and treat her with sympathy rather than resentment. That concludes my report, Madam Chairman.
Okay. Councillor Coombs.
I'm going to make a statement. I wish to not align myself with the final comments made by Councillor Cameron following point four. I do not agree with them.
Thank you.
Are you referring to Slade Road?
No. Partly that, but I think the point you made after point four, I will not allow myself to, because you're simply going down the same line as everybody else, just that's not the way to be doing it, to be criticising other people. We've heard enough of it tonight and other nights over the last 2.5 years. And I, for one, am absolutely fed up with the back teeth of it.
Me too.
Okay. Right. Councillor Ward.
Madam Chairman, the title of this agenda item is to discuss public participation. I think given the last 10 minutes, quarter of an hour, perhaps most councillors are not in the mood to deal with that item at present.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I would propose that it goes on the agenda in January with two options. One, that either this council agrees to keep public participation largely as it is, without debate between councillors and the public, or if it wishes to look more constructively at changes, it sets up a small working party of councillors to look at this and to see what might be done.
Would you like to set up a working party from this meeting to report to the January one?
Well, given that we've got some councillors missing, I think
leave it.
Given the lateness of the hour,
yeah,
we might well be prepared to think more constructively in January.
So,
second
you'd second
yeah.
that? All
yeah.
those in favour? Okay, so we'll defer that to January and we'll make we'll add in the two options under that agenda item.
Well, we seem to have had to discuss public participation on more than once, so either we've got to make a real effort to do it or say we're not going to.
Yeah, that seems eminently sensible. Okay, moving on to